The U.S. government recently announced plans to fund research on geoengineering. They plan on blocking out the sun with sunlight-reflecting particles sprayed into the atmosphere to cool the Earth. Now, while I was researching this, I came across some other related stories like cloud seeding, the idea of making it artificially rain wherever you want. And then, down the rabbit hole, I went further until I got to the decades-old conspiracy theory of chemtrails. So is the US admitting to chemtrails? Is that what's going on here? Let's figure this out together, because this research was some of the most fun I've had. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Hoymiles. Now, this was the winning topic in our last poll, so be sure to subscribe and vote on what we make next. Okay, so what do we know so far? Last June 30th, the White House released a report titled Congressionally Mandated Research Plan and an Initial Research Governance Framework Related to Solar Radiation Modification. This report immediately made headlines, since in essence, it's a mandate to explore solar and other rapid climate interventions to lower the Earth's temperature in a matter of a few years. Now, this sounds promising, but we're talking about weather intervention on a global scale through solar radiation modification, or SRM. This is one of the main forms of geoengineering, and it's got a lot of people in a panic. Now, this type of intervention could have potentially catastrophic consequences that we can't even begin to imagine, but more on that in just a little bit. But why does this matter, and what does it have to do with the popular conspiracy theory from the 90s? To understand that, we need to dive into how SRMs work. The idea behind solar radiation modification is to make the upper atmosphere reflect more of the sun's radiation into space instead of letting it penetrate the atmosphere and warm the Earth. It's the same principle behind adding a reflective coat on the rooftops of buildings to help keep them cool. So yeah, the government basically wants to study ways to wrap the Earth in an equivalent of aluminum foil to keep the heat out. In theory, and depending on the scale, this could dramatically reduce average global temperatures, countering the effects of our greenhouse gas emissions. But how do they plan to pull this off? The report mentions researching two key approaches to SRM. Marine cloud brightening, which aims to make clouds brighter by injecting sea salt particles into them. And two, a technique called atmospheric aerosol injection, which is a fancy way of saying spreading aerosols into the upper atmosphere. And that's where millions of people went, "I knew it! We were right about chemtrails!" And if you don't know what I'm talking about, allow me to explain. Few conspiracy theories have captured the public imagination as much as the chemtrails theory, except maybe the fake lunar landing theory, but that's a video for another day. The chemtrails theory suggests that the long-lasting trails left behind by high-altitude jets are actually chemicals or biological agents deliberately sprayed by secret government or third-party agents for nefarious purposes. Depending on who you ask, these purposes are spraying chemicals for mind control. Some people believe big pharmaceutical companies are purposely spraying toxic chemicals to help keep us sick to buy more medicine. Others believe they're fertility suppression drugs for population control, something like the plot of Dan Brown's novel Inferno. But most believe it's a massive covert geoengineering experiment for weather control, aka secret SRM experimentation. Now, I have to admit, the first time I heard about these chemtrails, I kind of brushed it off because I didn't really see much validity to them. But after reading the reports from the White House, where they plan to block out the sun by spraying aerosol in the atmosphere, I thought, this might deserve a closer look. The first thing I learned is that almost 1 in 5 people, 17%, literally tens of millions of Americans actually believe in chemtrails. That's when I really made up my mind to go down the rabbit hole. I mean, if the statistics are right, thousands of you watching this video right now believe in chemtrails or some variation of the chemtrails theory. So we gotta figure this out and give both sides a fair shake. After all, powerful governments don't exactly have a clean track record, and they've done similar things in the past. For example, in 1950, the US Navy conducted Operation Sea Spray, a biological warfare experiment in which they secretly sprayed two types of bacteria over the San Francisco Bay Area in California to see how vulnerable the city was to bioweapon attack. The UK once did the same thing between 1940 and 1979 without telling the British public either. The question is, are they doing it now? Now, real quick before we get into that, I gotta tell you some good news about my electric bill. We finally have permission to turn on our solar system, and we used Hoymiles for our microinverters because they make top-notch, super-efficient, long-lasting microinverters that take the DC from your solar panels and invert it to AC for your house. Apart from being really efficient and high quality, they're also incredible value because they make 2-in-1, 4-in-1, and even 6-in-1 inverters, which allow you to connect to multiple panels, saving you money. Here's a look at our build before solar and after solar. This is June with solar. And thanks to data from our smart panel and HoiMiles app, here's how it breaks down. The HoiMiles app shows me that I produced 1.37 megawatt hours. The house used 1,140, so that means my bill, amazingly, negative 230 kilowatt hours. And June is notoriously cloudy here in San Diego. For July, we're on track for 1,800 kilowatt hours. And by saving about $700 a month, that means we'll break even in about 3 years. I love HoiMiles so far, and they get the top recommendation from me. Check out HoiMiles microinverters using our links in the description. Huge thanks to HoiMiles and you for supporting the show. Okay, let's step back and see where the conspiracies started. The chemtrail theory started in the late 1990s after the US Air Force published a report on June 17th, 1996 titled, Weather as a Force Multiplier, Owning the Weather in 2025. This report followed a directive from the Chief of Staff of the Air Force to examine the concepts, capabilities, and technologies the United States will require to remain the dominant air and space force in the future. This is basically about using the weather as a weapon, something the US military had already tried before. We'll get back to that in a moment. In addition, several patents for weather control technologies such as cloud seeding and SRM popped up during that decade, and most used airplanes as a delivery vehicle. It's safe to say that this probably got a lot of people looking up at the sky. Then people started noticing that the condensation trails left by airplanes were now more abundant, often longer and more persistent than usual. Someone, somewhere, put two and two together and speculated that these airplanes were actually part of a covert atmospheric spraying operation, and the theory took off. So, are chemtrails real? And if not, what are those white trails left behind by airplanes? Those white lines you sometimes see behind jet airplanes are technically called contrails, which is short for condensation trails. They're basically long clouds made of, well, water present in the turbine's exhaust. Jet turbines are basically glorified internal combustion engines that burn jet fuel. As with all combustion reactions, this produces water vapor and carbon dioxide. When that hot exhaust hits the atmosphere at cruising altitudes of 30 to 40,000 feet, where the air temperature is negative 40 degrees to negative 70 degrees Fahrenheit, that water vapor quickly condenses into a liquid and then freezes into tiny ice crystals if the conditions are just right. That's when we see a trail of condensed ice crystals, or a contrail. So, does this mean that chemtrails are a hoax? Well, not necessarily. Most chemtrail believers know about contrails, but they argue that they're not the same thing. The first argument a believer will tell you is that chemtrails can linger several hours in the sky, which is much longer than a typical contrail, and that they sometimes spread out, covering large swaths of the sky. I did some research to find out how long contrails last, and found that they can also last for hours in the atmosphere, just like clouds can. In fact, satellites have observed clusters of contrails lasting as long as 14 hours, though most remain visible for 4 to 6 hours. For example, here's a satellite image of a series of contrails taken near Canada at 12:05 p.m. on May 26, 2012. And here's the same photo 2 hours later. They're a bit more spread out, but the contrails are definitely still there. The second argument is that we only started seeing these contrails recently in the 1990s, but that's actually not true, since there are multiple photographs and video footage showing contrails during World War II. If people started noticing more contrails in the skies in the 90s, it could be because of the growing commercial airline industry. For example, a study found that increased air traffic was responsible for a significant increase in cirrus clouds forming over the US between 1971 and 1995. What that's telling you is that our thirst for air travel has already literally changed our weather patterns around the world and around the country. It truly is a case of a butterfly flaps its wings in South America and a zombie gets diploma in South Korea. What is the expression? There are two other pieces of evidence that are worth mentioning. The first is that a group of researchers found a new type of highly toxic, reactive, and unexpectedly long-lived chemical compound called hydrotrioxides in the upper atmosphere. Chemtrail believers took this report as evidence that someone was spraying toxins in the air. But I read this study and found that these compounds actually formed naturally in the atmosphere and lasted just 20 minutes in the air. Now, that's way longer lived than chemists expected, but it's still just 20 minutes. If someone was spraying this stuff at 40,000 feet, it would never reach the ground. But there's another piece of evidence coming from one of the strongest proponents of the chemtrail theory, a website called geoengineeringwatch.org. They recently published a 2-hour documentary on geoengineering and chemtrails called The Dimming that I watched as part of the research for this video. They lay out the entire case for a global plot between governments worldwide agreeing to cool the planet off in secret by blocking out the sun through SRM. According to the documentary, they plan to do this with tiny reflective particles of alumina, and of course, this recent report from the White House strengthens their case. Several things about the documentary caught my attention. One, they showed white trails switching on and off intermittently, which I frankly can't explain. They claim it's the pilots turning the sprayer on and off, which I don't know. But another thing they did was fly a plane through a series of alleged chemtrails, took samples of the trail, analyzed them, and found alumina nanoparticles in the air. They did a second flight in another location with different equipment and found high concentrations of very tiny nanoparticles in another series of contrails, though they didn't say what those particles were made of. Now, the scientific community said the results were inconclusive because of bad sampling, but that doesn't mean they're necessarily wrong. This got me thinking, could there be other ways to explain the presence of these particles in the trails? And I think there is. There are many natural sources of nanoparticles like volcano ash, dust clouds from the Sahara, and smoke from forest fires like the ones coming from Canada. Many industrial processes also release nanoparticles into the air. One study found that the aluminum surface treatment industry produces nanoparticles at a concentration as high as 7 million particles per cubic centimeter, more than 10 times higher than what the guys at geoengineeringwatch.org found in the atmosphere. But more importantly, jet engine exhaust is also loaded with different types of nanoparticles in very small sizes, so finding nanoparticles in a jet's wake may not be that surprising. So in the context of the chemtrail theory, SRM techniques have attracted the most attention, but weather manipulation and cloud seeding are also a big part of it. Many people claim that the High Frequency Active Auroral Research Program, aka HARP, which is the world's most capable high-power high-frequency transmitter, can be used to control the weather. Cloud seeding is a form of weather modification invented in the 1940s by Vincent J. Schaefer. The idea was originally tested in 1947 in Project Cirrus, when the US military and Schaefer flew a plane into Hurricane King trying to reduce its impact on the East Coast. Cloud seeding works by shooting silver iodide into the clouds using salt flares or by spraying them with dry ice or salt. The idea is that these particles provide a surface around which water droplets and small ice crystals can form and clump together, helping them fall as rain. It's like when you see small droplets of water on your windshield that don't move, but when two drops fuse together and make a larger drop, that larger drop slides down your windshield, picking up more droplets as it goes along. Water seeding has been used to increase snowfall in ski resorts, to reduce hail damage caused by thunderstorms, and to reduce fog. It has also been used in some countries to increase the amount of water available for agriculture. But cloud seeding has also been used as a weapon. It was used in Vietnam in the 1960s, making it the first confirmed use of meteorological warfare. Now, it didn't really work at the time, but it outraged the international community, and in 1978, an international ban was passed on meteorological warfare and many other weaponizations of the environment in the form of the Conventions on the Prohibition of Military and Any Other Hostile Use of Environmental Modification. But in 1996, the US Air Force report that triggered this entire chemtrail conspiracy theory proves that the US never let go of the idea of using the weather as a weapon. The international ban really gives strength to the idea that the US would conduct these tests in secret. Cloud seeding has been institutionalized in China since Mao Zedong's rule, where they employed more than 35,000 people throughout the years to help seed clouds. This has created a lot of tension between China and India, where flash floods and droughts are becoming more common. Some Indian government officials blame China's cloud seeding program for these atmospheric anomalies. But it turns out that cloud seeding is also common practice right here in the US. There are several companies that employ pilots with small planes to seed target clouds on demand to increase rainfall in desired areas. And can you guess who pays for those missions? The government. Well, not the federal government, but counties. This means there really are government-sponsored airplanes spraying chemicals like silver iodide over your property, and it's not just commercial jetliners. As usual, this proves that there's always some fact behind most conspiracy theories, however far-fetched they may seem. One thing I found interesting about these local cloud seeding operations is that one pilot admitted that counties would often cancel a mission if there was too much wind because they wanted the rain to fall on their county and not the neighboring one. This reminds us of the fact that the atmosphere doesn't have borders, and what you do in one place will undoubtedly impact the world at large. This brings me to the most important part of this video, Engineering is all about fighting gradients to control the world around us. When we build a house, we want the inside to be comfortable, even as the outside might be too hot or too cold. But we need to learn to choose our fights carefully. We have to be humble, or nature will come back to bite us. Whether you believe in chemtrails or not, the fact is that geoengineering is a real field of study, and it's a dangerous one at that. We're talking about intervening on the weather at a global scale, literally playing God, and there's no way to know for sure what will happen if we do. I mean, come on, we can't predict the weather 2 days from now as it is. Do you really think we'll know the effects of massive large-scale cloud seeding or SRM projects? As an engineer, I gotta say the answer is no. There really isn't any way to know. According to Robert Merton's law of unintended consequences, these effects can either be beneficial, negative, or downright perverse. An example of an unintended benefit would be aspirin, which, aside from being a great painkiller, also acts as an anticoagulant that can help prevent heart attacks. Pretty helpful. Negative unintended consequences, on the other hand, are a dime a dozen. For example, when Thomas Midgley Jr. invented leaded gasoline and later Freon gas, little did he know that he would unintentionally kill the most people anyone ever killed on Earth. Another more relevant example of an unexpected drawback is that the seemingly harmless contrails left behind by jets aren't actually as harmless as they seem. A study found that air traffic and contrails are responsible for a significant increase in cirrus clouds over the US, unintentionally reducing solar radiation over America. This map from MIT shows the average contrail coverage in 2019 over the US, and it really shows how significant this effect can be. And sometimes things don't just go wrong, they completely backfire. For example, there's a fascinating story from back when the British colonized India. Their officers were getting stung by king cobra snakes, very common in India. And so they came up with a plan. Every Indian that brings us the corpse of a killed king cobra would claim a reward. And so for a couple of years, the king cobra population started to decline, and the British thought they were so clever. But by the end of the decade, there were more king cobras in India than ever. So what happened? Well, the Indians started raising king cobras. They'd incubate eggs and raise them, kill them, and bring in for reward money. This is one of those things where you can't really fully understand the consequences of something until oftentimes it's too late. And in the case of SRMs, it feels like a rather foolish approach. It lacks a sense of first principles thinking, in my opinion. The problem is we're burning stuff at an alarming rate, and it is starting to cause problems everywhere. There are companies, insurance companies, pulling out of Florida, no longer willing to or able to offer home insurance for people living in Florida. Why? Because the hurricanes are just becoming way too destructive and way too commonplace. And this is the most ridiculous band-aid I've ever heard of. It's one thing to do things on a small scale, but when you're talking about the weather, you are making changes that affect people who never voted for you, who never agreed to it. It's just playing God to a level that I'm just not really sure is a good idea. I'm a firm believer in the theory of unintended consequences. I believe in some humility. I think we should understand what we don't know and accept that some of our consequences can be pretty profound in a bad way. And in this situation, why block the sun? Why not put up more solar panels? Go more and more solar. The good news is it's kind of happening. Coal is kind of dead. It doesn't even really compete with wind and solar because they're just a vastly superior product. Solar panels will last for 30 years making energy. This entire house, this entire building is entirely solar powered now and batteries 100% off grid, which is pretty cool. But there's other things that we can do that make more sense. First principles thinking tells you always go to the source of a problem. Don't start with any prerequisites or any other baggage that old designs used to have. Start from the source. We need to have a cleaner, better way of handling the planet. Do less things, make less chemicals. We don't know how they're going to last. Teflon, microplastics in the oceans. It's kind of becoming out of control. And the chemical companies can be kind of scary, all the things that they're working on. So what do you think? Hopefully this laid out kind of the story, the different rabbit holes we went into, controlling the weather, making it rain, blocking the sun. Chemtrails, actually kind of true. That one I would not have believed before making this video. Can't wait to hear what all of you guys think. And until next week, you gotta check out this video next. I'm Ricky Tupa Da Vinci. Thanks so much for watching.